All right, folks. So welcome again. My name is Wayne Dean with 3D Pro Services. I am the manager of the sales club through the American Business Association. Basically, we have three different parts of our company, which is sales coaching and fractional sales management, and then the private business club through the American Club Association. Each Thursday at 2 o'clock, I do these 1 hour sessions for club members through the ACA at the benefit of being an ACA member. But then I also have other clients that join us. I have over, she's 58 different topics. So we can go through a whole year, one topic every single week, and not duplicate any of the content that I have. Today's session is on bonding and rapport is the French word for come together. I think that's fitting with the Paris Olympics starting this week. But we'll talk a little bit more about the number one question I get from people is how do I deal with difficult parents? How do I deal with difficult prospects, clients, whatever it is? I get a lot of questions on how to deal with so and so. So we're going to dig into that today. But I want to make sure I don't do what's called a Christopher Columbus presentation. Anybody online know what that is or heard of this before? No?
Haven't.
Okay. So here it is. It's kind of a it's a presentation where the speaker starts to take you somewhere, but you don't know where you're going. And then once you get there, you really don't even know where you are. And when you get back home, you don't know where you've been.
Sounds familiar.
Well, sometimes we get into these trainings and they just start going off, and people don't have agendas and they don't really go over what the subject matter is going to be. So let me tell you what our subject matter is today. It's how to review, understand how people process information, visual, auditory, and kinesthetics. We'll review what people really want out of a transaction. I'll talk a little bit about the communications wheel and some DISC profile, and I'll go into if anybody's really interested in that, we can do a little bit more dig or deep on that. And then Dr. Eric Berne came up with the ego state. So these are the five areas that we're going to go over. And I guess at this time, I probably should make sure you guys are seeing the screen. I did share my screen correctly, right?
Yep.
Okay, good. Glad to see that. All right. So think about communications as the four-piece puzzle. First of all, how does this person or that I'm talking to process information? Are they visual? Are they auditory? Are they kinesthetic? And one of the things I teach salespeople in my classes, first thing to do is to kind of start to think, diagnose somebody. When you first meet with somebody, try and diagnose their style of processing information. So we'll get into that today. DISC is behavioral style. Some people think, and they've heard of DISC and Myers-Briggs and all these other assessment tests, and they talk about a personality. DISC is not necessarily a personality test. It's not measuring good or bad. DISC is just a Dr. Carl Jung came up with it in the 40s, and this backbone of modern psychology. It is behavioral styles that are either natural to one style or not natural. So we'll go into what the four different styles of understanding how people behave and why they behave. They are D's, I's, S's, and C's. We'll go into neuro-linguistic language, understanding words, tone, body language, and active listening, and then the different ego states that we are all in at one time. And I'll get ahead of myself right now, everyone on this call or anybody listening, you're in what we call your adaptive child state. The adaptive child state is that state of us where, well, I'll listen to what the teacher has to say. Maybe I don't agree, but I want to go to rock the boat. We learn best in our adaptive child state, but we'll get into the parent ego states, critical parent, nurturing parent, logical adult. So this is our agenda for today, so that I didn't do a Columbus presentation. You know where I'm taking you. And when you get done, you'll have the opportunity to go back and have access to the recording that we're done. So if you want to go back and I'm talking too fast or you didn't take notes, just sit back and let me go through this. If you have any questions, go ahead and put them in the chat box there or raise your hand. You're not going to interrupt me if for some reason I don't do a very good job of explaining to you what I'm doing. So, difficult people, they behave in the manner they do because one, they did not or they don't get what they wanted or they expected to get, or they've learned that this unpleasant behavior can get them what they want. Does temper tantrum ring a bell with anybody? Or they're doing what we call collecting rewards points. So, we'll get into each one of these three to understand why people behave the way they do. But people want transactions to be, they want it to be quick, right, cheap, easy, or personalized. In any type of a sales transaction, the buyer wants either to be quick. They want it to be done right. They want it, actually, people say don't use the word cheap, but that's what people want. They want an inexpensive transaction. They want the process to be easy, and they want it to be personalized to their needs. And I think everybody on this call, if you took your product or service and you started ranking in order what it is that your clients want, and then you rank again what you're best at delivering, you might find that they are in conflict with each other. You might sit there and say, well, all my clients, they say they want the product cheap. They really don't want a cheap product. They want it done right. They want the process to be easy. They want it personalized to their needs. Then maybe they want it quick and cheap. So many times I'll even start with a client when I'm meeting with them and say, hey, this is typically what I do best. What my people want from me is they want a personalized training program that's absolutely done right. And they want the process to be easy. They don't want to have to go through a lot of work to do it. And then last thing my clients want is a quick, cheap program. Is that going to be a conflict with what you want? And it gets me off of this price issue. If you lead with it first and say, what is it you're looking for? I doubt it's cheap. People, one, can't come back to you and say, well, price is paramount. I mean, if this is purely a price-driven transaction between you and your customer, perhaps there might not be a fit, because I'm sure most of the people on the call, your business model isn't to be the cheapest, the easiest, the quickest program. You're probably designing a personalized program that's done right. The process is easy, but at an affordable price, but not necessarily cheap. So think about these things right now: quick, right, cheap, easy, and personalized as to what if somebody didn't get. So think about it this way. Stop. Go back the wrong way. There we go. Stop. When somebody doesn't get what they wanted or expected, they become upset and difficult to work with. So again, try to understand of those five, what was it that person didn't get? Now, they might lead with they're upset because this was done wrong or that was done wrong, but it might have been one of those other five things that's really the underlying cause of their misbehavior. And I don't think we spend enough time going back and just really trying to understand why somebody might be behaving in a difficult manner. What is it that they didn't get? So remember three things that people do. One, they've learned that that type of behavior, unpleasant behavior, could get them what they want. They didn't get a quick, right, easy, cheaper, personalized. Or the third thing that's talking about is called reward collecting. And let me explain what I mean by reward collecting. We've all been able to participate in different reward programs, whether it be Southwest rewards programs. Even years ago, I related back to some people. I'm a lot older. I remember SNH and True Value stamps. You used to actually go in and get, based on the amount of purchase you made somewhere, you get a stamp. And then you put those stamps in a book, and you might get a book. If one book of stamps rewards would get you maybe a toaster, but five books might get you a microwave, and all the way to 100 books might get you a trip to Hawaii. What we're talking about is people in these different reward programs seldom immediately cash them in. I'm at Fuzzy's Taco program and I got over 5,000 points. Yeah, I could cash in 500 and get a taco, but boy, I want to be able to save them up all at once. And this is what people do. People collect emotionals and black and blue stamps from other people. What I mean by that is, let's say my wife and I are having a conversation and I say, well, I want to win this battle. And I start pulling from the past some other time. Well, you don't remember that I said such and such back 3 weeks ago, and you're pulling items from the past and trying to cash them in today. So what I want you to think about, sometimes people, they collect stamps from some other salesperson and they don't say anything about that transaction not being what they wanted. And then they cash them in all on you. And it might be in a sales role where a salesperson's doing cold calling and calling people up, and all of a sudden they get that one person, oh, it must suck to be you. I hate salespeople. Well, they didn't have enough time to really make a judgment whether they hate me. They just cash in all the stamps they collected from all those other 7, 8 o'clock at night after dinner phone calls that they got and cash them in on me. So I want you to think about it that way. As sometimes somebody is cashing in the rewards points that they got from somebody else. They didn't cash them in on that person, but they're cashing them in on me. And what that does is just helps you understand and deal with it, because it's not as important as to what somebody does to you. It's how you choose to deal with it. So from now on, I want you to think about somebody that's acting difficult to you might be just cashing in stamps that they didn't collect from you, but they're cashing them in on you. And we'll move in that same category. I don't know if anybody online can give me a guess what you think Albert Einstein's IQ was, and then maybe Madonna's and JFK's. Anybody have any thoughts as far as what they think the IQ is? Who had the highest? Nobody? Well, go ahead.
Obviously, I mean, I would say Einstein, but who had the highest IQ, but I have no idea what their IQs were.
Well, you're absolutely right, because Einstein's was 160, Madonna's was 140, and JFK's was only 119, but he was president. But it turns out, really, your IQ scores pale in comparison to your bonding and rapport quota, your BQ scores, when it comes to predicting your success or professional achievement. Actually, research carried out by Carnegie Mellon Institute of Technology shows that 85% of your success in life is due to skills in human engineering, your personality, your ability to communicate, negotiate, and bond with others. And shockingly, only 15% is really due to your technical knowledge. Again, it's not what people do to you that's important. It's how, but more importantly, it's how you choose to deal with that behavior and manage your own reactions. And I get a lot of companies that talk to me about the struggles they're having with hiring people, and hiring sometimes people right out of college that don't come to them with the soft skills that they need and how to communicate. They might have the technical engineering background, but they don't know how to communicate with people, because I don't think we spend enough time talking about how one should communicate with other people. And that's why this training tends to be so important to most people, is how I teach you how to understand communications and working with other people. And one of the tips I'll give you, because a lot of people say, well, you know, yeah, boy, we can talk about this, Wayne, but yeah, come on, give me some tips. One of them goes back to the Muhammad Ali rope-a-dope. And again, I have a lot of younger people on this call that maybe an older reference lost on younger viewers. But in the, it was called the Rumble in the Jungle. This was a fight between Muhammad Ali and George Foreman before he had four kids named the same name and started selling hamburger grills. But Foreman was just come off of the Olympics. He was 6'4", 230 pounds, chiseled. Ali had just come out of semi-retirement from his struggles with the induction into the army kind of situation. And everybody thought Ali is going to get creamed, that Foreman is just going to kill him. But Ali and Angelo Dundee came up with a strategy. And this, I always like that line that, you know, strategy eats tactics for breakfast. So do you have a strategy over just tactics? Well, he had a strategy. The first thing that goes out in a boxer is the legs. So you can, that's just from standing, going through the round, everything. That's where the legs get really weak. And so what his strategy was, that he was going to go against the ropes, and he would just let Foreman punch and punch and punch. And he just went against the ropes, covered up, and Foreman was pump body blows and hitting him. But every time he actually hit him in the arms, he absorbed that shock and leaned back into the ropes. And it really didn't hurt him that much. He just, but, and he, by 10 rounds, Ali was losing in points, like 130 to like 80 points. He was losing. But Foreman had just basically punched himself out. And what happened was then, and he comes out in the last round, and Foreman's arms are down because he just can't fight anymore. And Ali took one swing and knocked him out. It's called the rope-a-dope. Well, how does that deal with us? Well, this is what I want you to do, that when you start getting these difficult people and they start complaining or arguing or whatever, don't go toe-to-toe with them. I have a saying that I hope it doesn't offend anybody, but don't get into a blank throwing contest with a skunk. You'll lose every time. When we, you know, when somebody calls up, well, you guys screwed up and the order didn't come on time. Well, just calm down. I can't talk to you when you're like this. That's not what they want to hear. What you need to do is say to them, you know, I can appreciate why you're upset. Boy, can you tell me more? Or because, I was telling one person this morning at one of my, at the chamber meeting, that Walter Cronkite, he was one of the greatest interviewers of men. Again, many people don't know who that is, but he was a broadcaster on CBS, and he was one of the greatest interviewers of all time. And in his book, he said, you can ask somebody because three times before it gets annoying. So when somebody starts complaining, you know, you guys screwed up. This is it. Because, and what happens is they punch themselves out. And then you can have a conversation with them. Let people get it out of their system. So I would think people remember stories more than they do statistics. So the next time you're dealing with somebody who's dealing with you in a difficult manner, let them punch themselves out. Boy, tell me more. That must be a problem. I can really understand. And only at that time when they punch themselves out, can you start to have a verbal conversation on the same level with them. Now, I understand that's sometimes difficult to do, but I think that those of you that are listening to me today, you have enough self-confidence, enough self-worth that you don't have to win every battle. Let the person punch themselves out a little bit, and then you can move on to finding out what it was that wasn't done, you know, quick, right, easy, cheap, or personalized. So that's the first tip that I'm going to give you. So let's get into some of these other parts of the puzzle again that we're going to talk about. Let's talk about the communications wheel. Now, I'm going to put it up here between words, tone, and body language. And I bet almost everybody can probably figure out which one is which as far as communicating with somebody. The words are only 7%. The tone is 38%. And our body language is 55%. And most people can tell me that when I put this slide up here, but then when they get into a reciprocating transaction, a conversation with somebody, they throw this out the window and they forget how much body language has to do, or even their tone. It's completely different when you say somebody like, did you steal the money? Or did you steal the money? It's where you put the different tones and emphasis on certain words that changes the complete conversation as far as a communication style with them. So start remembering that when you're interacting with somebody, that body language is 55% of your communications. Words are 7%, tone is 38%, and again, body language only 55. So body language, make sure you do a good job of making eye contact with somebody, because when you don't look somebody in the eyes, it really to them can signal deception or even a lack of respect on your part to that person. Be careful about your slouching. I know mom always said, sit up straight, but it really is important because bad posture signals to others that you really lack confidence in your product or service. And don't angle away from somebody. You know, when I teach basketball, one of the things I teach kids when they're shooting like a free throw is to square their shoulders to the basket. And the same thing for you. When you're having a conversation with somebody at a networked event, square your shoulders up with that person, because if you stand off to the side, you're deflecting, you're angling the conversation away from, and it shows that you're uncomfortable with that conversation. So square your shoulders up with somebody. Fidgeting, touching your hair, playing with your clothes, it reveals that excess energy and can also show some discomfort or anxiety on your part. Obviously, we get this where people say, don't fold your arms, because obviously most people tell me, yeah, that shows that I'm, you know, closed off. But it really can be a signal that you're disinterested in them and you're not buying into their message. And I had one guy last week tell me, well, I'm fat and it's a good way to rest my arms. I can appreciate that, but try not to do it if you can. And folding your arms shows you're disinterested and not buying into their message. Even if you are, it's just the body language is what they're reading. Don't keep looking down, because when you look down while you're trying to make a point, it loses all its power and makes you look weak. So in everyday interactions, you need to look more comfortable and very conscious of yourself. But if you look down, it shows that you're not that interested in your own conversation. Frowning or scowling, you know, scowling and frowns, often unintentional for us, can communicate unhappiness or disagreement. And sometimes, those of you who see me right now, I have to say to people, hey, I had Bell's palsy. And when I had Bell's palsy, this side of my face actually becomes paralyzed. And I've only come back about 90%. So this side of my face droops a little bit because I don't have full muscle control. The ulnar nerve back here controls feeling and functions on this side of their face. And I have to say to people, hey, I'm not frowning on purpose. Just that when I talk a lot, I'm doing a lot of training and I get tired, it looks like I'm frowning. So I have to explain that to people, that I'm not doing it purposely, because they could read it as unhappiness or I'm disagreeing with them. this is an important one. You know, when you're closer than a foot and a half away from a colleague or somebody, you're treating their possessions, office space, as if it's your own. It signals disrespect and that you don't have a clear understanding of personal boundaries. So be careful when you're invading other people's space and realizing that there's a body language in itself right there. So that's that was the first part of the words, tone, and body language, this piece of the puzzle. Now we'll go on to the visual, auditory, and kinesthetic part of this puzzle. So how we process and take in information is completely different than how we communicate with words, tone, and body language going out. This is how we process information. 55% of the world is generally visual people. Visual people need to see things, and they'll actually say words like, hey, come on in. I need to see what you have. Show me what this is all about. They process information visually. They're more animated. As you can tell, I'm visual. I'm used to speaking. I'm the fastest talkers, visual people, because we have a movie in our mind, visual people, and our mouth is usually three frames behind. Visual people will make a mistake verbally, but we'll keep going because we figure you still got the picture anyway. We think in pictures. So a lot of people, what I want you to start thinking is when you're diagnosing somebody you're talking to, listen to the words that they use. If they say things, show me what you have. I need to see what this is all about. That's a visual person. Auditory people say things like, can you tell me more? I need to hear about this. Kinesthetic people is touchy-feely. Kinesthetic is about feelings. Kinesthetic is, have you ever heard somebody say, you know, I can't put my finger on it. It was a gut decision. Well, I will tell you, the decision really wasn't made in the gut. The decision was made in the neocortex part of their brain, where they start processing information based on a feeling. Visual people will talk the fastest. Auditory people, the next slowest, and then the really slow people are kinesthetic, because it's important that you understand how they feel. Visual people require a lot of attention. They really like using graphs and data and those kind of things. Auditory people, about 20% of the world, their dominant style is auditory. And if I'm going to send out this to everybody, and I'll also send it to the visual, auditory, and kinesthetic test that you can take that'll tell you which is the dominant style that you have. They're usually a combination of two, but there's usually one that is the most dominant style of you. Again, auditory people will look up almost like there's a bubble cloud of written above them of all the words. I think I heard you say, I think you said. They will repeat the words often because they need to hear them say it. That, you know, prospects believe only half of what a salesman tells them, but 100% of what they say. So when you have an auditory person that uses auditory clues and you're a fast-talking visual salesperson, most of your information is going over the head. You need to leave time for them to repeat back the message. And that's what active listening basically is letting the client, I think I heard you say, did you say it this way? Make sure I understand. Auditory people, they are usually the middle child in the birth order. I do a whole training on birth order. And the reason is because they heard it from both sides. They heard it from the firstborn. They heard it from the lastborn. They're usually play the referee in conversations with people. Again, background noise can really bother an auditory person. But then there's another auditory person who can't study without having some music or something in the background. But again, their communication style is mostly they need to hear it. They need to hear it from you. And showing them a bunch of flip charts or showing them a PowerPoint presentation doesn't go over as well with an auditory person. The kinesthetic people. Kinesthetic people generally are the last born because they've been told stories of kids. They were the baby in the family, and they were treated with a lot of kid gloves kind of things. Typically, they're brilliant business people. But again, they take slow, deep breaths. They're very patient. They're very intent with you while they're talking to you. And when I'm helping an organization hire somebody, if everything was equal, as far as experience, knowledge, all that kind of things in a candidate, I'll usually test that candidate. And if the person is auditory or kinesthetic, they actually make better salespeople over the visual salesperson because they listen. Auditory and kinesthetic people are great listeners. Now, sometimes that visual person, the fast talker, doesn't understand it and thinks they didn't get it because it doesn't sound like they're they're paying attention, but they're really listening to you and they take time to think about it. So kinesthetic people make the best salespeople. So start thinking about how this person processes information. Kinesthetic people, they'll actually do the two-hand handshake, that kind of person that shakes your hand and touches on the forehand, or they slowly even pull you toward them into their office. Kinesthetic people are comfortable with touch and feel. And again, they will decide to buy from you because they got a feeling that you are the right person that they want to engage with. So start using the same. The best tip I can do without spending a lot of time on this is whatever type of words that that person uses, auditory, visual, or kinesthetic, use the same words back to them. Because it's called a cross transaction. If somebody says, auditory says, come on in, Wayne, I need to hear more about you and your organization. And I respond, oh, wait till I show you. Wait till you see my PowerPoint. You can see right now that we're not bonding. We're not coming together because we're talking from two different points. So again, you need to understand how this person processes information so that you can communicate to them your information in the best way that they will receive it. All right, let's go into our feelings today on what's called PAC, parent, adult, or child ego states. Our feelings today, as you sit in here today, how you feel about what I'm saying, how you're taking in this information from me, it's called transactional analysis. And the story is Dr. Eric Berne came up with this whole theory years ago. And what he was doing is actually he was teaching lawyers how to pick juries. And as he's teaching these people in the back of the room, one of the attorneys just started giggling and started laughing. And Dr. Berne stopped and I'm sorry, sir, there's something going on. Oh, I'm sorry. The little kid in me just came out. Has that happened to any of us where the little kid in us just came out at the wrong time? We're in church and maybe the pastor said something that made us laugh or somebody else made us giggle and the little kid in me came out. So he started studying this and realizing that at any one time, we're in either our parent ego state, we're in our adult ego state, or we're in our child ego state. And your parent ego state is made up of either critical parent or nurturing parent. The adult in us is the logical part of us, and the child of us can be the rebellious child, the adaptive child, or the natural child. So, and we switch from these ego states really quickly. The story I use is this. Suppose you're on a plane, you're going on a business trip. Now you realize that the worst part of the flight was actually the car ride to the airport was the most dangerous because flying's actually pretty safe. But during the flight, a recorded message comes on from the pilot that says, I'm sorry, there's a problem in the cabin. The oxygen mask will soon deploy from the overhead compartment. Please place the oxygen mask on yourself first and then any child traveling with you. Now, how do you feel at this point when this happens? You feel a little anxious. You feel a little scared even. But what do you say to that little child that's traveling with you, the 8-year-old girl that's traveling with you by herself? You'll say things very nurturing like, oh, honey, I'm sure this is not a problem. I'm sure it's going to be okay. Here, let me put your mask on. You're very nurturing. But the pilot's recorded message still goes on and comes on again to put your mask. But now the oxygen masks don't deploy. Now, how do you feel? Even more upset, a little bit more critical. Man, what's going on with this airline? I can't believe this is going on. But again, you're very nurturing to the child. Well, after a while, the pilot's real voice comes on and says, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry. There was never a problem with the oxygen mask or with the cabin pressure. Instead, there was just a problem with our tape recorder. Don't worry. Everything's okay. Now, what do you say to the flight attendant who's going up and down the aisles trying to reassure everybody? You'll say things like, well, at least I better get a drink out of this. My point is we go from critical parent to nurturing parent to logical adult the critical child. We go through all these different ego states at any one time. And difficult people will go through their rebellious child state. And critical parent messages, they're judgmental, they're prejudicial, they're statements of right or wrong, acceptable or not acceptable. Like examples are respect your elders, don't talk to strangers, don't ask so many questions, speak only when spoken to. These are all these messages you got from your critical parent when you were younger. They're the favorite words like don't spill your milk or look both ways. Answer my questions. These are all things you get from critical parents. Nurturing parents are more loving, supporting, like nobody's perfect. Let me kiss to make it better. mommies will make it better. I know you did your best. It's all I care about. You get one for trying. That parent ego stated in the form of messages or statement on what to do, say, or act. It usually comes from that supervisory part of our management program, those of us that manage people. But again, what would you rather have had, that critical parent or that nurturing parent? Now, most people say, oh, I had a very critical parent, but oh, my mom was nurturing, my dad was critical. But that's sometimes forms how we act with people today in our life because of those experiences that we had. The child in us could be the natural child, the fun-loving, the part of it that still wants to crack jokes, that wants to have a lot of fun. Now, a lot of salespeople will tell me, oh, I'm really successful in sales because I'm a natural child, I have to have fun. I think people buy in spite of it, not because of it. And I'm talking about that salesman who thinks he's the funniest person in the room. Again, people buy not necessarily because of it. Or that rebellious child in us, or the adaptive child. And then there's the one that we call, you know, that natural child, that fun-loving, creative, spontaneous part of our personality, fun-loving at the company picnic, playful at the office, joking with others. The rebellious, that angry, fearful, intimidating, the words temper tantrum ring a bell with anybody. Early in life, this child learned how that type of behavior can get them what they wanted. And that goes back to our second slide that we have. The difficult people will often act in a difficult manner because they learned early in life that they can get what they want by offering that type of rebellious behavior. So I'm going to skip ahead to this and say, okay, let me go to this one slide. There we go. This is my slide. All right. So you, 70% of your behavior should be your nurturing parent, 25% the logical adult part of you, and only 5% of maybe the natural child. The customer, remember, the parent in them monitors behavior. The adult balances the risk versus the reward. The child likes to please. So I always like to sit there and say, the child in us likes to buy. I hate to go shopping for clothes, but I sure love to go to Cabela's and buy things. I like to buy. The parent in me says, yeah, it's okay. And the adult says, yeah, there's enough money in the checking account to go through and write that check. So when you communicate to somebody, think about it this way. Your nurturing parent can talk to their adaptive, their natural child, or their rebellious child. Your logical adult can talk to their parent. Your logical adult can talk to their adult. But your little child can't talk to anybody. And that's where we have these transactional analysis problems with people that are difficult because they act in a rebellious manner. So we go in a rebellious manner. And you find that it doesn't work that way where you can child the child. So the reason I put this slide up here is, again, I think most people can appreciate this and say, yes, I need to be nurture, 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 and logical, 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 even if they're rebellious and they're acting in their child state and they're acting in their critical parent state. I need to stay nurturing. I need to stay logical. That's the only way to have a reciprocating conversation with somebody. All right. And then as we go through this, the last bit, I can do DISC. Let me look at my time here. All right. I've got one last bit here that we can do, and that's on DISC profiling. At this point, I'm going to stop and ask if there's any questions, comments, anything you want me to go clarify. Go ahead and open up your mics, anybody. Nobody?
It's all making sense, Wayne.
Okay, good. Yeah, appreciate the feedback, sense. Carl. Thanks, Jack. All right. Does it make sense as far as why people behave the way they are? And that's what the kind of understand the quick, right, easy, cheap. Boy, if you remember anything, just the quick, right, easy, cheap, and personalized. What is it that you deliver? What are you best at delivering? And is your customer getting it that way or the way that they expect it? That's usually where there's a conflict somewhere where they did not get what they expected, right, easy, cheap, quick, or personalized.
Well,
all right, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I'll speak from experience. I mean, that really helps me because the truth is that in the county that we're located in, here in Kansas, we have a high concentration of engineers, financiers, if you will. So we have a lot of people that really, they see everything through a very statistical, they want to process it. They want to think about it. They want to look at it. They want to process it. You know, I even had one client who said, you know, just send it, you know, can you just send it to me? And I was like, well, I only made one change, you know? And I said, that's really the only difference is he goes, I know, man, I just need to see it, mm-hmm. you know? And he just wants to see it overnight. It's like this, yeah. like trigger in their brain of like, they have to look at it and see it with their eyes. And, cause he wanted to close that day and we had already gotten it all taken care of, but he was like, I just need to see it overnight. And I'm like, all right, that's fine. You know, so,
kinesthetic people are the type of people who say, I need to sleep on it.
Right. That's like 90% of the people here in Johnson County.
That's okay. What you have to do as a salesperson say, well, I can appreciate that. That makes sense. Because they need to feel that it was a right decision and they can't, right. they don't have that feeling right now. And if you push them to a decision, the decision will be a no. So,
yeah, well, the weird part
it sounds like this act. Hey, that makes sense. Act. Let's do this. Why don't you sleep on it? Tomorrow I'll call you at 10 o'clock. And tomorrow at 10 o'clock, we'll either decide it makes sense to move forward or I'll answer the additional questions you have. And if I can't answer them to your satisfaction, then we'll decide probably not a fit. Would that be fair or does that make sense? That's now, good. Add always try and add this to your repertoire, if you will. Does that make sense? Would that be fair? Because mama taught you to play fair, and the logical adult in people wants it to make sense. So when you're asking somebody, hey, would you like to buy my product or service? Don't do it like that, because that could just end up with a yes or no. Say, hey, would that make sense? Would that be fair? Now they're answering, yeah, that makes sense, or yeah, that's fair. So give those people time to think about it. If you're a high D, and we'll get into that next, the D, you can push people away. So, and I'm sure there is a lot because of what you say, because of the type of environment you're in, there are certain categories of people that kind of dominate the landscape.
Right.
So I can appreciate that. Okay. Anybody else, Carl, or anybody else? All right, let's get into DISC. And I'm a certified DISC profiler. And DISC basically says this. There are four different behavioral styles, D's, I's, S's, or C's. Now, before I go any further, I got to explain to you, you can usually be a combination of two, maybe three, very seldom four. But you're usually, you can be a D to an I, an I to an S to a C to a D. What you can't be is 50% D and 50% S, or 50% I and 50% C, because they're diametrically opposed to each other. Somebody in that position where they take the score and they find out they're 50% D and 50% S, we usually call those people Sybil, meaning schizophrenic, that they don't know who they are. So let me get into the D's, I's, S's, and C's. Again, D-style people, they're very tough, they're very decisive, they're strong-willed, they're competitive and demanding, they're independent and self-centered. Under pressure, they show a lack of concern. You might sit there and say, I don't understand Bob. He just doesn't seem to have a sense of urgency. It's not that he's not concerned. It's just they don't like to show it. D-style people, and by the way, in the United States, 14% of the U.S. population, their dominant style are D. D-style people, they fear loss of control. They're afraid that they have to be in charge. And that's where the D comes, very direct, very decisive type of people. They fear that they won't be in control. So if you find somebody that's a D after you've gone through my program with them and you're able to identify styles of people, the worst thing you can do to a D person is, oh, don't worry, this is a complete turnkey operation. We'll take care of everything. No, Ds want to be involved. They don't want it to be a situation where they're not processing it or involved in the decision-making process. So some D-style people, Madonna, Patton, even characters in movies and TV shows like Dallas, Bobby Knight, former coach that I actually was recruited by to play basketball. These are some high style D people. I style people. I is woohoo, influential. I stands for, boy, they can influence people. You've heard that person say, boy, I could sell refrigerators to Eskimos. People love me. They're the life of the party. 33% of the U.S. population is I style people. They're very sociable. They're talkative. They're open. They're enthusiastic and outgoing. They're energetic. They're very persuasive. Under pressure, though, they look disorganized. If you go through your office and you see somebody with the messiest desk, those people are typically eyes, because it's all about having a good time. And the last thing they think about is being organized, but it's all about having a party. Here's what they fear. I style people fear social rejection. High style people will call you and say, hey, Carl, let's have a cup of coffee. Let's meet for coffee and network. Let's have lunch together. And if you said that, oh, God, no, I'm too busy. I have lunch. They take it real personal. You just rejected that person socially. So I'll always say to somebody when somebody says, hey, can I get you anything? Cup of coffee, water, soft drink. A lot of people say, oh, no, I'm fine. Well, if that was an I person to deal with it, you just rejected them. They might have just brewed a fresh pot of coffee for you. They went and got water put in the refrigerator, and now you rejected them. So from now on, when somebody says, can I get you anything? You want a cup of coffee, hot chocolate, water, anything? Your response should be, are you having any? And the reason I say that is because most people, when I do this training, would say, oh, yeah, I'd love to have a cup of coffee. Well, what if they was just a D-style person? They were being polite. A D-style person, very direct, very decisive. They don't want to get you coffee. So the response to somebody, can I get you anything? Coffee, hot chocolate, water. Are you having any? It's neutral. You don't offend the D, you don't offend the I. And if they say, oh yeah, I'm going to have a cup of coffee, then learn to have a cup of coffee with them. I had a guy the other day that I took out on a sales call with training, and the guy offered him coffee, both of us coffee. And here's where they made the mistake. This guy took on training, a sales guy I took on training. Can you get you guys a cup of coffee? Oh God, I never drink coffee. I hate coffee. That's what the sales guy said with it. I'm thinking, okay, we just lost the sale. Because now, not only has he rejected his hospitality, which in some countries is taboo, but he just also insulted this guy because he says, I don't drink coffee. Oh, God, I don't know anybody can drink that stuff. He should have said, no, I had enough coffee, but I'll take some water if you have some water. Something like that, that would have not rejected this person's style of behavior. And again, here's a list of the type of people that are high I style people, very outgoing, life of the party. I style people, really high I style people, today, if they don't have weekend plans already made, they're starting to panic because haven't got their social calendar adjusted yet for the weekend. So I style people, it's all about having a good time. S style people are calm. They're a little bit more laid back. They're steady. They're family oriented. When you walk in their office, they typically have pictures already of their family on their desk. They might even have scripture and all, even in their outgoing message, hey, it's Wayne, I'm not here right now. Leave a message and have a good day in the Lord. They're very, very laid back type of people. They're great listeners. They're typically very modest and trustworthy. Under pressure, they're too willing. What I mean by that is, let's say we decide that we're going to have a company picnic. And I, you know, at the meeting, I ask, hey, who will be in charge? Who wants to run the company picnic? Nobody volunteers. It's the S-style person will eventually raise their, all right, I'll do it. Because they want to please people. They're too willing under pressure to do things. Now, we talked about D's, fear loss of control. I's, fear social rejection. Any thoughts here on what you think S-style people fear?
Change.
This is true. Yeah, that's one of them. Change, because it is actually falls into loss of stability or security. Yep. S-style people will even ask you, well, what's the warranty? And it's not that they won't buy. They just need to know. And for example, I'm a high D to an I. I've run my own business. I'm self-employed because I can't work for somebody else. But I'm always a high I, as you can tell by seeing me out in my talking. And I'm a high I. My wife is an S. The joke in our family is, I want $1 million so I can spend it. I win the lottery. You're all invited to a huge party that I'm having. My wife wants $1 million so she can save it. Because security is hugely important to her. As I said before, when I had Bell's palsy and I woke up one morning, this side of my face was sliding down from being paralyzed. And I leaned over to my wife, and I went, good morning, honey. And she could see that I was almost looking like having a stroke. I think the first thing she did is went to the safety deposit box to make sure my life insurance policy was up to date. I know it's a cruel joke, but S-style people, it's all about security and stability. Now, obviously, Gandhi and some people like that are the S-style people. But S-style people, again, they're the opposite of the Ds. Remember, Ds love change. A D-style boss will say, hey, I know everybody, we just tried Microsoft Dynamics, our CRM system 6 months ago. I'm not happy with it. We're going to go to Outlook, or we're going to go to something else. D-style people like change. The average D-style person has moved over 17 times in their lifetime, and that helped form their behavioral style. C-style people. C-style stands for compliant. They're precise. They follow rules. They're logical, careful. They're formal. They're disciplined. Under pressure, they're overly critical of themselves. They say, oh, but my accountant, oh, I can't believe I made that mistake. Can't believe I made that simple accounting. You know, they put a lot of pressure on themselves to be perfect. What do you think they fear? They fear failure. Criticism of their work. I'm sorry, I cut you off.
Oh, it's okay. Failure. I was going to say failure, criticism.
They don't like you. Yeah, they'll criticize themselves, but by God, you better not.
Yeah.
Like, that's right. I've heard salespeople say to somebody like, oh my God, who sold you this? Well, maybe you're saying somebody else made a mistake by selling you that, but they bought it. So you're criticizing them. The worst thing you can say, oh, I can't believe somebody sold you that policy, Zach. Oh my God, why did you do that? Because at some time they had to have made the decision. So it's insulting them. And once that happens, they'll still steal all your free consulting, but they've already made a decision not to buy from you. So I am a disc profile. I went through 3 weeks down in Houston, go through all this to learn these different styles of people. And after 3 weeks of training, Merku, the Swedish professor who runs this program, came up to me and said, hey, Wayne, I could just tell you're not really grasping this enough to be certified as a disc profiler. So let me give you the story. It's one of those stories that he had done. If he'd done the first day of training, would have made a huge difference. But he waited until the third week. He said, Wayne, there's four people in an elevator. You're running down the hallway. Hold that elevator. The D is the person closing the door on you. Hold the other end. The D's, nope, you weren't here in time. Goodbye. The I is the person holding the door. No, the more the merrier. Come on in. Hey, as long as you're here, let's have a staff meeting. Or the person wants to turn around, talk to, and have a conversation with them. That's the high I. The S-style person, the person against the back wall, not getting involved, just listen to the Burt Bacharach music over the stereo. Going out of my head over you. Right? So the D is taking charge. It's their starship. They're in charge. The I wants to have a party. The S is calm and laid back, not getting involved. What do you think the C is doing? The C person is doing the math. 1,500 pound limit, five people. How much do you weigh? So they're trying to be compliant. Yeah. So it was one of those stories. Think about it. The D wants to be in charge. The I wants to have a party. The S is calm and laid back, and the C is doing the facts and figures. So if you think about this slide, look, the D's are all about change and results. And as you come down to the I, it's more about people. S's and I's about people. D's and C's is about facts and figures. So Sam here, this is a chart of actually one of my clients. Sam is the kind of boss. So he wants to be in charge. But he wants everybody to like him. So Sam does things like this. Hey, Carl, I better have your expense report on Friday. Your expense report has been late the last 3 weeks in a row. It better be on my desk by Friday at 4 o'clock. And then afterwards, you want to go have a drink? It confuses people because, and I've actually had this in training where the D said, all right, guys, we just hired Wayne Dean to be our sales trainer. You're going to go to his classes. You're going to go every week and attend his sales training. And then somebody comes up to the boss and says, hey, Sam, do I really have to go to the training? I hit my numbers. Oh, no, you don't have to go. Right, because he wants people to like him. So a D to an I boss can really confuse people. So as I said, you can be a D to an I to an S to a C to a D, or backwards, a D to a C. You can go backwards. What you can't be is 50% D, by God, my way, the highway, and then and 50% S. You can't be the person who wants to be the life of the party, the I, but then the guy sitting in the cubicle just only doing computer work. It doesn't work that way. Now, doesn't mean I score right about here in the disc profile, right between the D and the I. I don't have any C. It's not natural to my style. I have filed an extension on my taxes 17 years in a row because I hate doing that together. But the last day in September, I'll meet with my accountant and I can get all that stuff together. I can be a C when I have to be. It's just a long ways for me to travel. It is not natural to my style. So again, a lot of people say, this is a personality test. And I go, no, it is just behavioral styles that are either natural to you or not natural to you. Doesn't mean I can't be a C, it's just not natural to my style. So when we talk about understanding why somebody's behaving the way they are, this might person, you say, you know what, that's just the D. The D style are very, very, very direct. They're very decisive and you'll take it personal. That D style person would have done that with everybody. And so understanding behavioral styles, why people behave the way they do, makes it easier for you to deal with their difficult behavior because now you're not taking it personal. You understand that's just a behavior that is natural to their style. Or if you as a manager are trying to push somebody to make a decision and then you realize, oh, that person's an I, that's not natural to their style to meet deadlines and to get things done. With them, I have to make it fun. It's got to be an interaction that is a people positive type of interaction. So this is my favorite slide in this whole thing. It's called my Nike slide. D style people are just do it now. A D to an I is, well, let's us do it. An I is, well, let's do it happily. An S to his I, well, let's do it together. A real S, remember security and agreements, let's do it as we agreed. An S to a C is, let's do it how it should be done. And a C is, let's do it right the first time. And then the DC is, I don't care. DC stands for don't care, just do it. So understand inside where some of these people you fit, that you're dealing with, fit, and you'll understand why they behave the way they do, and you don't take it as personal. That's what I hope you got out of this, is what can I do to interact with people to create a reciprocating transaction, a communication with a person that doesn't foster continued animosity between each other. So when you start thinking about D's are, what are we going to do? I's are, yeah, but who's going to do it? S's are, yeah, but how are we going to do it? And the C's then are, why are we doing it? This is an important slide for you, if you go back and watch this recording again and go back to the slide. And if you're dealing with any type of a difficult person, what was it that they didn't get? Who didn't do what they were supposed to do? How was it not done the way they'd expected? And why wasn't it done the way they expected? You know, difficult people behave in the way they do because they didn't get what they expected. And it's one of these things. But understand the style of the person will dictate what it was, how it was, who didn't do it, and why it made them upset. I leave with this one. Remember, Maya Angelou said it best. I've learned that people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. Think about it. People want to know that you care about them and their problems. So have that interaction with somebody remembering this quote. They'll forget all the things you did. They'll forget what you said. But how did you make that person feel during this conversation or this interaction? And if you made them feel correctly, then they won't be difficult. If for some reason you forgot that important quote, then you're going to have cross transactions with people. All right, that's the last of this. Comments, questions, thoughts from anybody? I'm open to anything else that you're dealing with that I could help you with. I got 6 minutes left of my hour.
Well, the question that I had actually, Wayne, is so you explained a lot on the VAK, how to kind of get a quick assessment of which space is somebody in, what's their preference. It wasn't so clear on the DISC categories. How do you pick up where people are more comfortable?
Okay, I do a whole training on how to diagnose DISC styles of people. And it all comes back to the line, people tend to buy from people they like and they trust, and people tend to like and trust people like themselves. So once you diagnose somebody as a D, an I, an S, or a C, then you need to be like that person and understand that we want that. Dale Carnegie said it best in his book written in 1932, How to Win Friends and Influence People. You want it to be like a mirror, like they're looking in a mirror, like, oh my God, this person's just like me. So understand that Ds can make a quick decision. If I'm an S salesperson, but the client I'm working with is a D, they can make a decision. The D prospect will say, you know, this sounds really good. I think we'll go with you. And the S salesperson go, yeah, but I want to press you. Why don't you think it over? And the D's, no, I can make a decision. No, that's all right. I don't want to push you. Well, call me tomorrow. Well, understand that I should have been more of a D in that position. That D was ready to make a decision. And transversely, if I'm a D salesperson and I'm selling to an S prospect, the S prospect is going to say, I want to think this over. I need to, you know, be secure in my decision. And if you push that person with any type of like the special offer, you know, buy today, the good offer's only good today, won't be here tomorrow, you're going to push that person away. So understanding how somebody behaves in the DISC profile is hugely important when it comes to making a sale, because you might not get the sale in the first 10 minutes, but you certainly could lose it by not understanding why this person is behaving the way they do. So I do a whole training. It's a much deeper than this seminar as far as how you can understand and diagnose a D and I and S or a C, and then how to relate to them based on their behavioral style. So
yeah,
it
makes sense.
Probably a lot more than you were hoping for today.
No, thanks.
Be glad to have a conversation with you about more about DISC. And matter of fact, if anybody wants to take the DISC profile, you can get a from extended DISC company I work with. They can give you a 34-page report on your behavioral styles. They ask you questions online and it comes back with a full report. It even dictates and says, based on your style, how you make decisions. There's certain, and so understanding how you make a decision to make a purchase isn't necessarily the way a prospect that you're dealing with would make that same decision. So understanding your process and not transferring that and assuming everybody's going to make a decision the way you do can help improve one's sales.
I'm an extremely high D and C, and everybody I work with is the opposite.
And does that create conflict for you or what?
Oh, some days it's wicked hard. Yeah. Yeah. And I've taken that test. Yeah. And it's hilarious. I mean, it's very funny, but to me, but it's, yeah, there are some days where I really have to back up and just remember, you know, how to work with different types of people. So,
well, just please understand that there are 7 different companies that administrate DISC and have followed the principles of Dr. Carl Jung. Some of them do really think that it's a personality, it's hardwired, your personality is developed by the time you're 7 years of age. The one that I subscribe to doesn't. Extended DISC says these are behavioral styles that you can work on. If you want to be better at one other area and you are conscious about your behavior, you can change. Like when I first took the test, I was a high D, a little bit of I, no S, no C. Now when I take it, I have a little bit of S in me. I'm starting to think a little bit about security and stability. I still don't have any C. It's not natural. So you can change. One can change behavioral styles and can adapt. It isn't necessary. This is who you are. You can't do anything about it. So
I don't mind. No, I like being an ID. I like it. It's just sometimes yeah. I have to remember, you know, it's just I have to remember that I'm the only one that is. And then I have to think about, you know, how I talk to people and that kind of stuff. So, yeah, because I took the Myers-Briggs 100 years ago and yeah, there's a lot to learn with that when you.
So the opposite, most of the people you deal with are high I's and
S's.
And S's.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the best advice I can give you, Deborah, is this: remember what it is that they fear. So S's fear social rejection. So be careful in your transactions. You're not rejecting them on a level that they could take personally. On the S's, remember they fear loss of stability or security. Salespeople have to understand that when somebody says, hey, can you give me 3 references? That person that's usually asking for references is typically an S style person. Because if you think about it, what are you going to do? You're going to give them 3 references. They're going to say anything other than wonderful, great things about you. Of right. course, your references are going to be great. But if you said that to somebody, they wouldn't take it well. If you, well, okay, you know, references don't mean anything. When somebody asks for references or security or warranties, you know, what were you hoping for? I'd be glad to give you 3 names of people that through my training. What would you hope they'd say to you? What would you hope? What fear would that help alleviate? So don't fight with them and say, oh, I'm not going to give you 3 references. Yeah. References are stupid. Go ahead and understand what it is that they fear and that you do not cause any more anxiety or fear because they fear social rejection or they fear loss of security or stability. Again, that's the most important thing I hope you get out of the DISC part is what is it each one of those people fear? You can use that not only to people buy, you know, emotionally, they validate logically later. So if your product helps them overcome whatever fear it is that is natural to their style, they're more likely to buy from you. So understand what it is that they're looking for out of their own DISC profile. And that's what this whole training was all about. I know we try and cover a lot in an hour. The idea is understanding what motivates people to behave the way they do. And again, as I said to the group that Carl saw this morning, my definition of sales is just influencing people to a mutually beneficial decision. What more noble profession could there be? Sales isn't about tricking, manipulating, conning, coercing, or tricking somebody to buy something they don't need or want, but understanding what it is that this person needs and wants out of this transaction and fully taking time to ask questions instead of just pitching. You know, most salespeople get into benefits and features. Let me take the feature of my company. We've been around since 1992 and convince you why that's a benefit because I've got years of experience. You know, that sometimes works. But what's more important is what is it this person hopes they can get from you that they couldn't get from your competitor? You know, you'll make more sales under my system, not because you have a better product or service, but because you do a better job of diagnosing a problem or a pain that the person has that you are uniquely positioned to fix. And it's amazing to me. Most salespeople tell me that bond rapport is important, but yet they don't do anything throughout the month to improve. And that's skill set right there. If you ask the average salesperson, tell me how much time do you spend a month sharpening your axe, getting better at your own skill set? Any idea what you think the average person's salesperson spends just in enhancing their own skill set? Any thoughts?
Maybe one or two percent of their time, maybe.
The average salesperson spends 4.3 hours either reading a book or going to sales seminar. Most of the time it's forced on. They have to go to this class or whatever. World-class salespeople spend 12 to 15 hours a month in self-improvement. Mm-hmm. And somebody like Carl, that helps, you know, as a business coach, people need to understand that, hey, you want to get better at what you do, get a coach. I have a coach. Mm-hmm. We all think that we can do it on our own without realizing that there are other people that have gone through it and paid the price and they can learn from us. But what is it that this person really is not spending enough time getting better at? And it's usually bond and rapport. A lot of guys come to me and want to, how do you close? What's the magic dust? Well, if I had it, I wouldn't give it to you for free.
Mm-hmm.
Where it comes down to, the first step in my system is bond rapport. If you bond and rapport with somebody, the other steps become simple.
Okay. Yeah.
All right, my time is up. I appreciate you guys. Anybody's got any questions, let me know. I will send an email to everybody as far as where this is going to be once it downloads and converts into a recording so that you can go back and watch it on my YouTube channel. Otherwise, send me notes or questions that you have at wayne@3dpro.services. wayne@3dpro.services, and I'll be glad to answer questions. Okay.
Thanks a bunch, Wayne.
You're welcome. Bye. Have a good day, everybody. Bye.